Hello everyone, welcome to the Jenkins Infrastructure Weekly Meeting. Today we are the 9 July 2024. Around the virtual table, we have myself, Damien Duportal, Mark White, Bruno Verharten, and Jerry Reddy. We won't have Kevin, neither Stefan. They are off or unavailable, and I don't know for Hervé. He will join me eventually later. Let's get started with announcements. So, first one, last week we had to burn, the word is maybe a bit too strong, but we have to consider a release to be superseded by a new one. So, the version 2.465 of Jenkins is considered superseded by 2.466, the one we are currently running on Infra CI and Weekly CI. We have a post-mortem issue opened about that topic. I think we are not out of the wood yet. Let me just add the link to the issue. It's a bit later. So the issue was caused by a bump on the version of the Maven release plugin. We are not sure yet if it is a real bug on the plugin itself, a behavioral change that require configuration change or something else.
Yeah, so Basil corrected me on that, and he's confident it is in fact a breaking change, a change that, and given that it broke the build, has his assessment is yes, it's a breaking change.
I agree with his assessment based on what I saw. However, the discussion, the issue we opened, I've put the issue on on the postmortem. I mean, they are asking us to retry with Jenkins 2.466. I'm like, okay, so that's also why I've created that issue, and I will share the issue in that our issue, our LDES postmortem with details on the Maven issue, so they have material. One of the most important thing I think is to point to them the command, the Maven command and option we are using when doing the release. Because right now the only links they have are to the code of Jenkins core, which do not have the Maven command used to perform the release.
I see. Okay.
So I believe we should continue. Today's release is using the older 3.0.1 version of the plugin. I believe we should give them more information. I've taken on myself to create an account on this Jira and earlier today. I will take care of reporting just to avoid having Basil being the overwhelmed by the amount of tasks, having to do one yet another task. So I'm gonna take care of reporting. Of course, in the scope of my Maven skills, I'm not as good as Basil or you, Mark, on Maven area. So that's why I will try a level one support, let's say, or exchange with them, and I will ask for help if I reach the limits. Is that okay for everyone?
That's great. Thank you very much for being willing to do that.
I think it's also important because that's an open source project. We're an open source project, so not only it's useful for us and me, I'm interested in that kind of topic, but also it's a, let's say, a way of helping each other. For sustainable open source. One last thing, I haven't written yet on the issue. I tested a setting during the package step, unrelated to the problem, but when we did the second release, to decrease the amount of errors when the Windows packaging is done. So I will open a quick pull request with explanation. That's a configuration change on the pod template on release CI. That just increased the timeout, so we don't have to recreate a new pod every X minutes. Because in that case, we know it's every time it's 14 to 16 minutes to pull the image. So no need to retry creating a pod for 20 minutes at least.
So you'll increase the timeout. I'm very grateful. That's great. Is the change altering the timeout? What is the change again?
That's the change that tells Jenkins Kubernetes plugin not to try to recreate a new container. It
Ah.
creates the container and by default it waits 1,000 seconds before deleting it and try a new one.
I see.
So the goal is to increase at 20 minutes timeout. So we are sure that we had plenty of time to pull the image and start the process.
Thank you. Thanks for the clarity. I had just not caught it. Great.
That's a minor improvement, so no worries. So back to the, we have the post-mortem. We were able to release 2.466 and we are using it on Infra CI. Thanks, Mark, for taking care of the change log. I believe there is nothing else to do for now except following up the topic. And today, the release 2.467 started on time, of course, as usual. Still using the Maven 3.1.1. One fail. So that means we might need to reintroduce the 3.1.0 plugin once we will know a bit more. Maybe it's just config change to the breaking change. There is something to do in the future. Release plugin. Thanks, Bruno. Good point, because Maven 3.1.1 is confusing. Any question on the weekly releases, either last week or this week's?
No, thanks for handling it last week, and thanks especially to Basil for his help with it. Thank you very much.
And Stefan and Daniel helped us also, so thanks everyone. Doing that alone would have been so painful. Next week, I propose we cancel the meeting because I won't be there and I'm not sure the team availability is here. So unless someone objects and leads the meeting instead of me next week, I don't mind. I propose we cancel it since it's summertime and we do a 2 weeks releases like we did last month. Is there any objection here first?
No objection from me for canceling. When we're not here, we're not here.
Okay, cool. So, Mark, may I ask you to cancel the meeting next week?
I will do
But
that right away.
cancel it with your Jenkins Google account and not the CloudBees one. Otherwise, it will just cancel your participation to the meeting.
Yes, I will do that. So
Anything?
next week, the 16th.
Absolutely.
Oh, and next week, the 16th, is Java Patch Day. So we will have work to do after that. Not, we don't have the, it doesn't
Sure.
justify
Okay.
a meeting. It just says that
Okay.
that's the day Oracle release patches.
For infrastructure, usually it's 2 to 6 days after the patch day. Time for Temarin to publish their installer at least.
Right. Okay, I don't see a meeting on the 16th on my calendar anyway, so I think we're
Oh.
already fine for the meeting having been canceled.
Okay, but for everyone here, please be aware that there won't be this meeting next week
Right.
and cancel it from your agenda. Good for everyone. Another announcement, still around the CVE for OpenSSH. We still have one minor task to do. There is a pull request draft in progress, even if we patched the OpenSSH immediately on these machines. On the AWS Jenkins account, we have three virtual machines that have an OpenSSH, meaning no IP restriction. The goal for the pull request is to improve a bit more safety by restricting the public IP that anyone can use in order to join these machines. If your IP are not up to date on the sh Terraform shared tools, no worries. You can always go to the AWS console for the people who have access to it and add your personal public IP or if you want to move manually on the security group. So pull request draft in progress. I need to spend a bit more time. I did a first draft that should be done this week. Any other announcement? Nope. Let's have a look at the upcoming calendar. So next week we will have the 2.468 weekly release of Jenkins. I don't know if it will have the new Maven release plugin or not. If it has, I will ask you to check it carefully. But no infra problem. If it tests and fails, we do the same thing as what we did. We did no such operation except cancel the build and run a new build. So no specific infrastructure things if it fails. However, tomorrow there is an LTS release 2.452.3. Please don't break the infrastructure. Mark, just confirmation that release will stay on Maven 3.8 and JDK 11 on the release and package part as expected.
Yes, that's correct. And
And yes, so go ahead.
Hervé confirmed to me yesterday, just as you did, that yes, he fully expects that the container build will do exactly what we want, which is stay with Java 11.
Cool. So Hervé and Stefan should be able to be the lead checkers. So Stefan will check the package part and Hervé the Docker part. I will be there as support level 2, but since I have dentist appointment, I will be async or last minute in case of emergency. Thanks guys for taking care of this and helping.
Yeah,
Any cool.
and that pattern will hold for another 3 months. So we will do the same 4 weeks from now, and 8 weeks from now, and 12 weeks from now.
Cool, good to know. So don't break the infrastructure tomorrow, please. As usual. That's for me mainly, but not only. We don't have any Jenkins advisory announced on the mailing list. And a quick check of the upcoming credential expirations. So we are doing better and better thanks to the work that Stefan and Hervé did on automating. So automating means creating pull requests proposing a credential rotation. It's not doing the credential by automation that need a human, and that's okay, and it's wanted. However, having automated pull requests avoids relying on Google Calendar, which do not have shared notifications. So I hope with this method we will improve our ability to rotate credential before expiration. We did Let's Encrypt this week. We have a bunch of Terraform Azure state that have been updated. That have pull requests that tells us we have to rotate credential. 16 and 17 July. 22 July, we have the CI Jenkins IO credential used to spin up virtual machine agents that need to be that will expire. And we have few file share credentials used mainly by trusted CI, Jenkins IO, or Infra CI to deploy websites to production, such as the Javadoc, Jenkins IO, or other sites like this one. So this pull request will require an issue. One, so we already have one for the Terraform state as your SP. We need one for the file share credential and one for CIG. They will be automatically added on the upcoming milestone, and we have to do it before the end of life. Any question on the upcoming calendars and announcements? Okay. Let's have a quick look at the cloud budgets. Azure CDF paid, we have consumed 1,172. We are in the normal. Forecast says 4.3, but that looks like a bit pessimistic. Especially since with the ARM64 migration that we restarted Friday and the work that Stefan did related to hard drive, we saw a slightly decrease. So we should be at 4.1, 4.2 eventually. Let's keep that correctly under our eyes just to be sure we don't have something consuming more than expected. About the Azure sponsorship, we have consumed a bit more than 2K this month. That's a forecast at 7K. That looks good compared to last month. That was a 7.3. So we continue using these credits. That's good. DigitalOcean consume way less than the other months, of course. So let's keep it like this for now. And AWS, the Cloud Biz account, is forecasted at 6K. We have 1.8K, so good. That means our efforts are paying. We can see variations due to the amount of requests to the update center, especially since we have an LTS release that will generate a bit more of outbound bandwidth in the days after the release. People updating their controller mainly. That's all for the Azure Cloud. Nothing, no anomaly, nothing specific to focus on. We are on the, let's say, normal consumption, but we have to keep it under monitoring. Is there any question, point, things to add on the cloud budget? Nope. Okay. So let's get started on the work we were able to finish. With the help of Stefan, we worked on factorizing a set of Terraform data on the Azure Net project. We moved these things on a module. A Terraform module is a kind of function that avoids reusing the same thing. It's kind of templating. The goal for us was to put a stop on some human mistakes that we did in the past weeks related to the network and the NAT gateways. So that has been done, and that was a good opportunity for us to detect something missing. Release CI controller, only the controller, was still using the former outbound network system. It was using load balancer from the cluster. So its outbound IP was different than the rest of the private cluster. So that IP is used for contacting GitHub and cloning pipelines at the controller level, and also when connecting to the update center. So now it has been fixed because we detected that problem during the refactoring. Any question on this one? Next one, we rotated credential used to validate Let's Encrypt certificate from trusted CI virtual machine and cert CI virtual machine. We need an Azure credential because we use DNS challenge for Let's Encrypt. So that require the Let's Encrypt certbot to create a DNS record, and you need permission for doing that. That's the goal of these credentials. They have been rotated on a dry run of the certbot was able to create DNS record and remove it on staging. So should be fine. The biggest one. Thanks, Stefan. Thanks, Jay, for the work you did on Kubernetes 1.28. We migrated the public cluster, that was the last remaining one, to this version. So now we are running Kubernetes 1.28, which is supported until October on Azure. No problem, no bad issue. Everything went really fast for that last cluster. Jay participated and helped us a lot by creating the pull request related to the management on Kubernetes management system and Terraform. Thanks, Jay. And we have a new issue created for Kubernetes 1.29 that will be done before October, of course, so in the coming 3 months. We haven't discussed when do we want to do this one, but the issue is there. Jay, did I miss something about Kubernetes 1.28, or do you have something else to add on that topic?
No, I think you covered everything.
Any question, clarification from anyone else? Nope. Okay. Next issue we were able to finish. The free Kubernetes managed controller we have, Infra CI, Weekly CI, and Release CI, are now using ZRS SSD, which mean we can move this workload across availability zone while we were stuck to only one in the past. Additionally, we see a gain of one to two. No, it's more than that for this one. I think we should have a $30 to $50 or less to pay because we have optimized the storage. We kept the initial size. We used the maximum size we could use for each kind of disk, but these disks are now standard SSDs. Also, we now have a procedure to migrate data and control the kind of disk we are using from Terraform. We don't let Kubernetes manage these disks. The goal is that now we can increase the size or change the kind of disk we are using without having to stop the service. We can do it dynamically, while Kubernetes does not allow that. Any question on that topic? Cool. We had a close as not planned issue. We have a user having problem with the password. I guess they should look at the spam folder. Thanks, Hervé, for double checking. They tried to reset their password twice with success. The email were sent to their Gmail inbox. So yeah, we asked the user, they never answered, so we closed the issue. Now let's have a quick check at the tasks that are still in progress, and let's see if we need to continue working on this task for the upcoming milestone. The postmortem about last week release. So needs, as we said, we need to provide more informations to the Maven release plugin maintainers. We have to track to completion the bump of this Maven plugin in Jenkins core, which means we will close that issue only when we will have had a successful weekly release with the 3.1.0 or another version, but with the latest available version. We are not, Jenkins Infra, responsible for all these bumps. That's a shared responsibility with the developers of Jenkins. But we are the last in line, and we are the only one having access to the release CI process most of the time. Developer don't. So that's why that's a shared responsibility, and we need to have that issue open until we have fixed, the issue is fixed collaboratively. Does it make sense for everyone? Is there any objection on that course of things? Is that okay? Okay. So that will move from milestone to milestone, of course. So next action is providing data and see what happens. Any question? Nope. Next issue. So that one, I will move it back to the backlog. I've asked OSS Planet for a Jenkins mirror. Looks like they are not answering a lot of requests. So that issue comes from one of our mirror provider. I forgot his nickname, but that person said, oh, you also should ask there. I've opened a pull request or an issue, I don't remember, on their repository. That's the normal process. That's a request. And if they don't answer end of summer, we will close the issue with no answer, because that means they are not in, they are not capable of handling a mirror, which is okay. But that was worth asking.
So, and the intent there, OSS Planet, where are they geographically? Are they India based or?
No, I think they are in Taiwan, as far as I remember.
Taiwan. Oh, okay. Yep. Great. All right. Very good. So that would certainly be more geographically diverse, because right now Taiwan gets their service primarily from Tsinghua University. Great.
Absolutely. And I mean, if someone wants to provide a mirror, it's always a good thing for us if they are able to update it at least once a day. That wasn't any effort to ask for this one, so we'll see.
Great.
Any question? A word about plugin health core. So since May, no plugin health core is updated. It looks like the plugin health core application is facing failures. Stefan was able to share logs with Adrien. Adrien is under a big workload, so I'm not sure what to do right now. Adrien wanted to close the issue. Same for me, same. It's a shared responsibility. So I propose we keep that issue open until the scores are recomputed and updated on plugin Jenkins.io. Because it's not only Adrien's fault, we also have to help him to deliver a new version, to watch the log and ensure it's led to completion. So the issue here is open. I've asked Adrien if he want to pair, because he might need to have a short feedback loop instead of releasing a new version, waiting for us to deploy, waiting to compute, get the log. That can take times. So if he's okay, we can even try a snapshot version in production to see if he has fixed or if he need a real life debug, because maybe it's an issue we need to reproduce first. And once he has found the issue, then if we are there, we can immediately release everything and deliver it from that that tedious task.
Yeah, his load right now is very heavy with the Spring security project. And so if plugin health score is delayed even a month, I'm not going to feel badly about it. I realize that others will maybe edgy about that or concerned or frustrated, but Spring security is a very strict time limited project that has an enormous amount of work on it.
Quick question though, asked by Stefan. If someone really needs the scores to be computed, is it worth to revert back to the last known version, even if it means losing a feature? Don't have answer, but that's a question worth asking.
And I think it's worth asking Andrea, and I don't know which exact feature would be lost, but my assumption would be that would be okay, if that's really the problem. I'm not sure that that's always the problem. So if revert won't solve it, then reverting doesn't help. If revert would solve it, Adrian can advise, is that worth it? The challenge is his analysis of whether or not the revert would solve it.
Yeah,
It
exactly.
may be more than the time he can give to that right now.
I'll take care of asking him privately because it will be in French, so that will remove any ambiguity due to losing ourselves in translation.
Great. Yeah, I don't want, he's already got enough pressure on him with the Spring security project. We certainly do not want to amplify his pressure.
Let's move this to backlog until is available. Is that okay? I remove it from the milestone, we move it to backlog, and that's okay.
That works well for me. I think that way we're not closing it, but we'll make sure that he's not feeling like this is some sort of urgency that at least I don't perceive it to be. Yes, I wish we could update the scores, but it's not nearly as important as keeping all the Jenkins controllers in the world on a current version of Spring Security.
Good. Any question, objection, need for clarification on that topic, folks? Nope. Okay. Next topic, add JDK 21 agents everywhere. So we have started work with Jay. Started to work on providing Maven 21 and Maven Azure VM templates on CI Jenkins IO. Next VM Linux VM templates. Next candidate will be Trusted CI, but SSH launcher instead of inbound. So, Jay, tell me if you're wrong. Now you have worked and you start to have a better understanding of inbound agent, SSH agent. Now the task is on the rest of the Jenkins infra to provide Jay with an Azure service credential so Jay could create Azure VM from a controller running on his machine. That means a dedicated resource group on the Azure sponsored area dedicated for this. The service principal can only create VMs on this one. That would allow Jay to test his changes from the Vagrant virtual machine managed by Puppet. In any case, we saw that the inbound part is easy. We checked and we will work on this Thursday. We already have everything ready. It's only a matter of providing the proper templates. So it's just changing YARA data and that should be okay for CI GO. However, for Trusted CI, we will face the following discussion. Should we implement SSH launcher? Because the problem is, how do you set up SSH connection to override the Java home and path environment variable in a way that it is available for the SH or BAT pipelines? And that one is not an easy one. I found a POC solution, so that should be okay to implement it with a bit of Puppet template. But maybe we could think about switching Trusted CI and Cert CI to inbound agent now. The reason we are using SSH is because what we did in the past, we didn't have virtual net peering connection. Now we manage virtual net properly, we should be able to do it. So let's see, we will start with CI Jenkins IO and we will decide next step.
Okay, so the idea is that we might be able to unify our agent technique across the entire fleet of CI servers rather than
Yes.
having some of them using SSH and others using inbound.
Yes, but on the other way, that will be better to manage both solutions, at least on Linux, because we never know the future regarding networks. So that's why I believe we should work the solution using the feature we are using is the init script. When Azure VM plugin starts a virtual machine, it runs a script on the machine before starting the agent process. That's the technique we use for the inbound agent because it allows us on Linux to create a systemd unit that takes care of starting the inbound agent process. So we write the secret URL and other environment variable on the systemd unit. We load it and start it, and that's all. For SSH, that means once we have found the proper file to change that OpenSSH will read when opening a session, we have to update the environment variable of that file, which means then Jenkins will SSH connect after the init script, will load the new variable, and will have the proper Java home. And I believe we should have both. So let's get started for the upcoming milestone. We will have 2 weeks. Jay and I meet Thursday. Time for Jay to finish the other prerequisite task or unrelated task. And Thursday, we start working on at least Maven 21 and 17 for CIGIO as a first step. Any question? Need an issue for tooling JDK 17 and JDK 21 on trusted and cert. So I need to create a new issue to help Daniel. Daniel asked for JDK 17 tool. That's unrelated to the agent. That's Jenkins tool configuration. We have everything ready, and also it's a bit of Puppet. Jay, if it's okay for you, we will implement this Thursday. So you will that will be a way for you to deep dive again in Puppet. Is that okay for you? Nice. Any other question on this tooling? Nope. Next one, migration of the leftovers to ARM64 in the public cluster. So, hey, that one has been fun. We were able to successfully migrate artifact caching proxy and key cloak in ARM64. Immediate consequence, the node pool we use for running Intel machines was decreased from 3 to 2 machines. So immediate cost improvement for us on the CDF Azure accounts. Now we have LDAP. LDAP has everything ready to work on ARM64, and our tentative to migrate it started with success. The LDAP process is there, no error, at least no error different than what we have today, except that when we connect, it says success in account app, but we lose all the attributes. I'm not an administrator anymore when I use the ARM64. And Jenkins controller fails to connect. So I've reverted that back to AMD64 for now. And we need to reproduce that problem on a local machine. That should be easy. We get a dump of the production and we try with our own account locally. The data is encrypted, so you can try locally connection and the local controller will see the problem. There are many, let's say, issues here. For the first one is that the LDAP version we are using is on Debian 10. So we might want to migrate to a more recent version. It's still LTS and supported. It's patched security-wide. The package LDAP is patched and still supported. However, using either a modern version of Debian or even better, the switching to Ubuntu to homogenize with the rest of our images could be a thing. Because having a more recent version of LDAP might solve issues on ARM64. Remember, we need encryption with OpenSSL, which is really sensitive to the kind of CPU you're using. Second, we have what seems to be a word configuration on the certificate used to connect and bind to LDAP from the client. We don't have a full certification chain that generate a lot of warnings. So maybe fixing this will also help or not. So we'll see. Finally, we have the mirror bit instances, two container for update Jenkins IO, the new system, and two container for the current get Jenkins IO. So Hervé was able to discuss and check a bit this topic in the past weeks and months. So right now the status is mirror bits will have a release soon, at least. We don't know when, we don't know how. What is sure though, it will be a 1.0 release, breaking change release. So that means if we want to have ARM64 right now, we might want to build our own binary on the version 0.5.2 that we are using in production by using what was used for the release 5 years ago on the Travis system and see how it behaves. The alternatives will be scheduling these AMD64 leftover services on what we call the system pool, where we have technical component for Kubernetes running. That means we should be able to get rid of the Intel node pool, two less virtual machines, 3 to 4 machines for ARM64, and we will pack as much container as possible on the system pool, which is still using Intel. That will allow us to decrease cost. Because right now, since we have part of the workload on ARM64 and part on Intel, we are paying to 5 to 7 machines instead of 3 to 4. So the gain we were expecting by switching to ARM64 is not there at all because we need all of the workload on either ARM or Intel. Otherwise, it costs us way more due to the overhead of having different kind of machines. So that's all for this one. We learned a lot of things thanks to Stefan's procedure to migrate data, which we did with the artifact caching proxy. Interesting way of using stateful set for people doing Kubernetes. And now the next step will be reproduce the issue on LDAP. That's the most prior thing. So reproduce LDAP issue on a local ARM64 machine. And Hervé pointed me something I forgot. Thanks, Hervé, for the reminder. We have an open pull request on the Docker mirror bits image to build our own. Check if we can build and run mirror bits ourselves on Intel. So this will be the two next step on that task that we keep on the milestone. Any question? One, two, three, no. Okay. Next issue, update Jenkins IO. So yesterday we successfully merged the pull request on the Update Center 2, which features our new system for the credential. Now, instead of spreading credential everywhere and having too much coupling in the script, we now rely for AirSync, S3, and Azure on a zip credential file, which has one file per kind of destination. So we can parallelize the AirSync with the other task, which is good because we gain from 30 seconds to 1 minute in the execution. We can test the script and mock out some part, either generation, plugin copy, or some tasks that are easier for the upcoming. So now the next step for this one are first, we are going to update Hervé's PR on Update Center 2 to introduce the new Azure redirect HTTP file share. Because right now we changed the method, the implementation on the script, but we haven't added new destination yet. We will have to introduce the second Cloudflare bucket. That's the same kind of thing. We had a new destination. Right now, we are copying data on three destinations: the current machine, the Azure initial file share used by the new mirror bits, and the S3 Cloudflare in Europe. So we need to add the second Azure part for managing update center redirection at mirror orbit level. And we need to add Cloudflare in US because today it's, the update center runs on US. We need a location for our US users. Now, also we have crawler update delivery. So here we have a nice software engineering in Jenkins issue. Update center is a freestyle jobs that run on shell script. These shell scripts have the ability of automating from a list of destination the copy in parallel of metadata. Crawler is doing the same thing on the same destination. The only things that changes is that crawler copy inside the dot slash update slash subdirectory, while the rest of the update center data exclude that directory. But we have to find a way to improve changes between both. Right now, we have a draft pull request that will be updated tomorrow, later today or Thursday, most probably, that allow crawler to use the new destination credential. The gain for us administrator is that we won't have split credential. Right now, we have twice async the async configuration, but twice the same in a freestyle job and on this pipeline job. Same for the SSH key and same for the new Azure credential. So at least right now, the first iteration, crawler won't reuse exactly the same thing as update center, but it will update the new system. So each of these new one will result on an associated pull request on crawler. Otherwise, the new update center won't work because it needs the plugin metadata, but also the tools installer from crawler. And add the two above. Once we will have this free, then we will be able to resume load testing. So we are going to work on this. Is there any question or need for clarification on this one?
So the second Cloudflare bucket, I didn't ask at that point, that is that likely to increase our costs to the point we're in danger of exceeding the Cloudflare budget when we're in operations?
Yes, that could be. But on the other hand, if we open the service with only one Cloudflare location, particularly in Europe, that will be a problem.
Ah, okay. So so even if the cost is high, and I'm assuming that if the cost is high, we still expect it to be less than the cost to continue hosting on AWS.
Exactly. And you have to take in account something. Using two different Cloudflare will spread by, let's say, half. But it will spread the initial load. The load is the same in entrance. It's just do we want all the load to go on the Cloudflare in Europe, or do we want it to be spread based on the originating request to two different locations? But the amount seen by Cloudflare will be the same.
Ah, right. Okay. This is not an increase in number of requests. It's
Exactly.
merely a change of where we process the request.
Absolutely. Additionally, if we introduce new mirrors that we maintain, for instance, the new AWS 60K credits could be used for this, we create update center virtual machine mirrors, and we can copy data and spread even more the load. For instance, we could create in Asia that will be faster than Europe and US. And this one will get all the redirected load in Asia. We saw good result with this kind of method on getJenkins.io. The only constraint is we must control the mirrors update as part of the update center. That's the only constraint we have.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question on that topic? Hervé, do you have something else on this that we could have forgotten or that you saw? Cool. Now let's quickly check. We have a few issues that are in triage and that we have to consider adding to the upcoming milestone or not. First one is for you, Hervé.
We
Sorry, go ahead.
don't. Yeah, go. Sorry.
So that one was moved away 2 weeks ago to we have to decide. Is there work to do on this one? Is it closable? What are the next steps and the time you should spend on this one?
I've left this issue open because when the GSOC project will be finished, the URL of the previous website will have to be changed, and the new .jenkins.io will become stat.jenkins.io. But I can open a distinct helpdesk or close this one, stating that we will have to open a new issue when the new website will get its definitive URL domain. We don't
Okay,
need
thanks.
to keep it open.
Okay, so the new website is up and running. Congrats to everyone involved on this one. And we have a temporary URL. And if I understand correctly, we don't add this issue to the milestones and we wait for the end of the project. So that will be the time to get back that issue and milestone to switch to Indiana Jones, the whole name.
Right. Now, Hervé, I saw yesterday and I'm seeing again today that new.stats.jenkins.io is rather slow to respond. I assume that's not a surprise. It does eventually open.
Yeah, I noticed it that too today. I wasn't sure if it was my connection here. I don't know what's the cause for that.
Yeah, and that's not yours to diagnose. That I think that's a fair thing for us to ask the GSOC men or GSOC contributor to consider what's happening. Good.
Yeah, maybe open an issue on the repository.
Oh, I can do that. Right. I'll do that. Thank you.
And they'll decide if it need to be moved in an helpdesk set later. So yeah.
Very good. Because once it loads, it looks beautiful. It's absolutely lovely.
Cool. Thanks. That's a clear status for me. Thanks for the work. So we remove it from milestone until issue or until it's finished. Bruno, is that good for you in terms of GSOC point of view here?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so the idea again is that the third issue on shared responsibility area, which mean it's open here. We use the infra helpdesk, but right now we don't overload the milestones since there are no more tasks here, and do not hesitate to challenge that on every infra meeting. Even if you're not there, send us a message and we will plan as expected.
Thank you.
Cool. Next step, I've opened a few issues that we will have to take care. First one, we have Terraform 1.9 upgrade. We have moved away the update. We are running 1.6. It's supported. It's patched in case of issue. However, we start to have three minor version difference. So that issue is tracked to update the project. We have a protection, but that takes time to do it project by project. One of the reasons that triggered this issue is because with the work we did with the Terraform module with Stefan, we saw a lot of features that we could have benefited and would have, let's say, accelerated our work on Terraform 1.8 and 1.9. So that's why upgrading to this version should help us on the future Terraform work we will have. Especially, I'm thinking about the AWS part. We also have a Terraform state credential rotation, as mentioned earlier. Both of them, I believe, should be treated at the same time because for each of these two issues, we'll break the Terraform job main branch during the operation. So, since let's say the scope is not that much, Terraform 1.9 is the one that could move quickly, but we could do both at the same time. First, we break the project with credential rotation that let us time to test locally 1.9. Once we are sure that 1.9 work, since we use our personal credential instead of the one to be rotated, so that add a safety net for Terraform 1.9 on production because the job won't even try to use Terraform 1.9. So we will work on this one. And thanks, Hervé, for noticing that we are missing a Terraform state project for the Terraform Datadog project. For each Terraform public project, we have a private project where we manage the Terraform state, which is managed manually. And it looks like we are still using as the old Azure states created manually by Olivier years ago. So we need to migrate these states to something we manage, because Datadog states are an exception today. And we want them to be under the credential rotation system. Because right now it's using credential, we don't know if they expire at all. So I will add these three on the milestone. Priority will be on the two first one, and Datadog will be either worked on in the upcoming 2 weeks or moved away to the next milestone if we don't have time. Good for everyone? Any question or clarity on the Terraform part? No? Kubernetes 1.29. I propose we remove the triage and we will discuss during the team trimester planification. When are we going to work on this one? Most probably we should do it in August. If given we will have less person, so less risk to break the production. And the changelog at first sight wasn't that much. I'm more scared by the 1.30, but that has to be checked carefully. But we will have to work either in August or September. September, that means that's mandatory because Azure dropped the support of 1.28 in October. And October will be full of JDK 11. So let's discuss that for August. So right now we remove the triage. Finally, two Infra CI, Jenkins, GCASK, and Job DSL configuration issues. The first one, we have been really slowed on during the past week. Each time we have a GCASK reload, since we use Job DSL, all the jobs, multi-brand jobs, will have a scan that every time we have a reload or configuration change, it reload and it try to scan the repository, which absolutely exhausts our rate limit to GH, even if we're using a GitHub app. We have different solutions.
Damien,
sorry, go ahead. Yes.
Okay, you were going to talk to possible solutions. Great.
Yes, we have different solutions. The first one proposed by Irvin was splitting and spreading across different GH app. That's a direct and immediate actionable that we can do. So we could have one GH app for Docker jobs and one for Kubernetes jobs and one for Terraform jobs. At least that will prevent us and separate concerns. That's a good thing in any case. We could also fine tune. We have a lot of jobs scanning for tags, discovering tags when it's not needed. So removing this will decrease the amount of requests for each job. Finally, I found a bit of documentation and a thread on the community forum about a trait of the discovery multi-branch pipeline, which is skip on first build or first discovery, which means that will avoid checking during the initial rescan, because Jenkins job DSL delete and recreate the jobs, keeping its history. So each time we have a reload, that means we have a new job for each job. We have a new creation as if it was from scratch, which trigger an initial scan. We want to remove the initial scan while we want to keep the SCM webhooks to come in. I'm not sure that third one will work, but that's still worth checking.
So there once was a setting in the rate limiting configuration that could allow it to change its approach to the rate limiting. I believe it had by default a linear rate limit over time. It says your rate limit is this many calls over this time period, and you should not exceed the linear rate of that. And I changed mine to say, I'm going to allow peaks. You're allowed to spend up to the full rate limit before you throttle. Is this a bursty kind of load? I think it is, right? It tends to be a spike that arrives when we restart, and then it does not repeat over and over again.
Good point. Stefan, ask the same. We tried during a peak, but it was too late because the system was already locked out, so we didn't have time to retry the setting. So we see that setting. I don't know if that setting is even required, because since we use GitHub app, the rate limit should be so big that reaching it will be almost impossible. So right now, the rate limit is the Jenkins self-imposed rate limits. I haven't seen message on the GitHub API messages or requests back that we were rate limited.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so this is purely a result of a Jenkins computation, not some feedback from GitHub that says you're approaching your rate limit.
That was our understanding. Mm. We might be wrong, but that's what we saw on the documentation and the plugin code on GitHub branch source, that it was built for the PAT, the personal access token, which we don't use here.
Got it. Okay, thank you. Thanks,
thanks for the reminder. That could be an immediate actionable for us also. Say, we don't care, or even we can disable the rate limit, I believe, and see if we are rate limited on GitHub, we can always roll it back. But that could be a way.
Great. So I apologize. I need to drop off.
These were the last issues.
Oh, good. Okay.
So unless someone has something else to add? No? Okay. So we'll see each other in 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Thanks, folks. Take care. And have a nice day.
Bye.